Following program, Search the Scriptures, is brought to you by the Highway 5 South Church of Christ in Mountain Home. Speakers are Keith Sharp and Trevor Campbell. We invite you to call or write the church to submit questions for the speakers to answer. We'll provide answers from the Bible to your questions.
Trevor, will Jesus one day walk on this earth again?
Well, that's a good question.
Well, yeah. Okay, thanks, Trevor. Good evening. My name is Keith Sharp. I preach at the Highway 5 South Church of Christ in Mountain Home. I'm going to let Trevor introduce himself and the brethren in Piatt.
Yeah, my name is Trevor Campbell, and I do preach over in Piatt and worship with the group that meets there on Highway 62 in Piatt. And we're right next to the new Dollar General there in Piatt, pretty easy to find. You'll see on the screen there my phone number, 870-435-2737. Call me there if you have a question that you would like Keith and I to discuss on this program, or call me there if you have a question about the church that meets there in Piatt, or any questions about the Bible, or if you just want to talk about the Bible, have a spiritual discussion, feel free to give me a call there. And if you'd like to join us for worship, we meet on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. So if you're in the Marion County area, come out and join us for that. We'd love to have you.
And of course, my name is Keith Sharp. I preach at the Highway 5 South Church of Christ here in Mountain Home. And we have our services at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning for our regular Bible study. We have an 11 o'clock worship assembly and another 2 o'clock Sunday afternoon worship assembly. We have a ladies' class, an excellent ladies' class, currently studying prayer at 10 o'clock on Wednesday morning. And then we have our regular midweek assembly at 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening. You're invited to all of those services. We meet 1 mile south of the Highway 62-412 bypass on Highway 5 going down towards Salesville. And when you pass Good Samaritan, then look on the left for our sign. We're 1 mile south of the Highway 62-412 bypass. Now, I want to mention an event that we have coming up in August, and I'll say more about that, and we'll try to have a visual on for you later. August 6th through the 8th, we're going to have an event that we call the Gospel in Song. It will be singing, and we're going to have a song leader down from Manhattan, New York. Now, he's a faithful Christian and is a song leader up there, and he's going to be on Friday night at 7 o'clock, on Saturday morning at 10, Saturday afternoon at 2, and our regular worship times on Sunday. We'll say more about that as the time approaches, although it's getting pretty close now. So that's August 6th through 8th, a Friday night through a Sunday. Well, Trevor, the question that we have before us is, will Christ ever set foot on this earth again? Please give us a really good answer on that.
Well, like I said, it's a good question. I've been told that he will. People have told me that. People have told me that he won't. And I know, Keith, you're just like me. I'm not so interested in what people say as what God has to actually say. Somebody can show me in the Scriptures what, you know, which one is true, then I'll believe it. So, we want truth. And I believe the Scriptures, we can find it in the Bible. The Scriptures teach us what's going to happen in the future. I'm going to begin, Keith, for my part, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And I think this really just kind of answers the question, but I think there's a lot of other supporting passages that we can look at as well. But in 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, I'm just going to read a few verses here, beginning in verse 13. The Apostle Paul says, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep." The word asleep in the text means they've died, they've passed away. "Lest you sorrow as others who do not have hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then those who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." So in the text here, you know, Paul tells us what's going to happen. These the questions that surround the resurrection of the dead and so forth. Well, he gives us some information about what's going to take place there. But verse 17 is where he actually makes mention of the fact that we will meet the Lord, he says, in the air. And he says we will join or be caught up together with them, that is those who have already passed on, who are being raised from the dead, and then whoever is alive, if that happens to be us, if we're still alive when that time comes, we'll be caught up together with them in the clouds. And then he says we'll always be with the Lord. So no mention there of him returning to the earth or setting foot. I think the question was in regard to him setting foot on the earth. No, this text does not teach that he will set foot on the earth again. One of the things I find very interesting in the text is the mention of the trumpet of God. And I've got some things I'd like to say about that, some more to talk about there perhaps. But I'm going to stop and kick it over to you, Keith.
Okay, thank you, Trevor. Good start. And of course, we'll go ahead and explore this question some more. But now I want to apologize to our viewers because I failed to tell you how to get in touch with me to ask a question. And so if you'd like to ask a question for this program, and of course that generates the subject matter on the program is questions of our viewers, then you can call me at 870-321-5746. Or you can email me at keithsharp2021@gmail.com. Or you can simply write to Post Office Box 263 in Mountain Home, 72654. And Trevor, I think you told the audience how to be in touch with you, but you might go ahead and repeat that phone number so people know how to be in touch with you.
Sure, yeah, it's 870-435-2737.
So you can get in touch with either Trevor or me and let us know what your question is for the program. We'd be delighted to speak to you. We often get phone calls and people. In fact, this particular question was generated by a phone call. And so we're just delighted to receive those. You be sure and be in touch with us and let us know what your question is. And as we've repeatedly said, and this is the truth of the matter, we're not, as Trevor's already mentioned, we're not going to tell you what our opinion is. We're not going to tell you what somebody else's opinion is. We're not going to read to you from a church creed. We're going to show you what the Bible says about the matter. All right. Well, the question is, will Jesus set foot on this earth again? I want to stay in the passage that Trevor's currently looking at and make some notations about that in the light of current popular doctrine. Among the evangelicals today, one of the very most popular doctrines is called either dispensationalism or premillennialism. Those are both big names or big words, and you have to go to a dictionary or to somebody's uninspired book to find out what it is. But what it is the belief that when Jesus comes again, that rather than the earth being destroyed and everyone who is saved going to heaven with Jesus, that at that time, he's going to set up a 1,000-year kingdom on this earth. Well, first of all, that the saints at that time will be caught up. That's called the rapture. And they're going to be caught up into the air for 7 years in the earth according to... Now, I'm repeating premillennial doctrine. This is not what I believe. That the earth is going to go through a 7-year period of extreme trouble, the time it's called the tribulation. And then at the end of that 7 years, then Jesus is going to return and set up a 1,000-year kingdom on this earth and rule and reign from physical, literal Jerusalem on the physical, literal throne of David for 1,000 years. And that's a very popular doctrine. Of course, they talk about the rapture. At the time when the saints are secretly drawn out, they're raptured out, and nobody knows, nobody sees Jesus, nobody knows what's happened, except the saints who are taken away to be with him. Well, in this passage, there's two terms that are used that, according to the premillennialists, are separated by 1,007 years. It says, the coming of the Lord. If we believe, I'm in verse 14 now, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord. That word coming there is the word, a Greek word, parousia, and it does mean his literal physical presence. In fact, that's made clear in the next verse when it says the Lord himself. So this is not a figurative coming. This is not a representative coming where he sends somebody in his place. This is the literal second coming of the Lord. Now, according to our premillennial friends, that's separated by 1,007 years from the rapture. But if you skip on down to verse 17, then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together. Now that phrase caught up is the word harpas, that the Latin word is rapturos, and that's where our premillennial friends get the word rapture from that verse. But notice, those two things, they're not separated by 1,007 years. They take place at the same time, at the very same time that the Lord Himself will come again. The Lord Jesus Christ in His own person, when He Himself will come again, literally at that time, the saints are going to be caught up together with Him to meet Him in the clouds. And it says, thus they shall always be with the Lord. Not on this earth for 1,000 years, but this earth is going to, we'll talk more about this from another passage. At that time, this earth is no longer going to exist. And we're going to be with Jesus forever in a different place than this earth. So, as Trevor's already pointed out, this passage teaches when Jesus comes again, He's not coming to be on this earth. He's coming to take the saints out of this earth with Him to ever be with Him. All right, Trevor, I'm going to stop there and return it to you.
Well, I thought that was good, Keith, and you know, you approached that from an entirely different angle. You had some doctrine, and some of the things you just mentioned, I wasn't aware of some of the doctrine that's out there, so I like how you approached it from that angle. I was a little more blunt, I guess, in saying Jesus isn't coming back, but that's because, like I say, people have told me both, you know, I've heard that He's coming, I heard He's not coming, but I read in the Scriptures right here, it says that we're going to meet Him in the clouds, meet Him in the air. And so that tells me He's not going to return and set foot on the earth again. But I mentioned earlier the trumpet, Keith. I think this is a really fascinating part of the text when he talks about the trumpet of God sounding at the same time when the dead are raised and those who are alive are caught up with them in the air to meet the Lord, and then always from there on going to be with the Lord. But he says the trumpet of God. He mentions the trumpet of God sounding. And it's interesting. You know, trumpets were used for different things. You can read about in the Old Testament. In the book of Judges, and when the Israelites also took the city of Jericho, trumpets were used. Also in the book of Judges, trumpets were used during war. But God also uses the trumpet to gather His people. And it's an interesting text. If you go back to Exodus chapter 19, this is where God calls Moses up to Mount Sinai to talk with Him. And the trumpet of God sounds, and it is to gather God's people to Himself. And take a look, if you would. I'm going to begin in Exodus 19, and we'll see how these things kind of relate. But in Exodus 19 and verse 10, says, then the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes, and let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. So it's interesting. God tells them to prepare themselves and to wash their clothes and be ready for Him. Well, the same is true, I think, today for you and I, Keith. We're to be prepared for the Lord to come, whether He comes in our lifetime or, you know, we pass away and we're of those who are resurrected from the dead. When the Lord comes, we want to be ready, be prepared. The same thing He's doing here. Get all the people ready for Me. In verse 11, let them be ready. And then verse 12, He says, you shall set bounds for the people all around, saying, take heed to yourselves that you do not go up to the mountain or touch its base. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. Not a hand shall touch him, but he shall surely be stoned or shot with an arrow. Whether man or beast, he shall not live. When the trumpet sounds long, they shall come near the mountain. So there's the instruction. When they hear the sound of the trumpet, the trumpet's coming from God. It's not man making the trumpet noise. It comes from God. God makes this trumpet sound. And what's He doing? He's gathering His people. Well, that's the same thing we're seeing over there in 1 Thessalonians. And this is just a likeness of what is to come, God gathering all of His people. Verse 14, so Moses went down from the mountain to the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. And he said to the people, be ready for the third day. Do not come near your wives. And it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain, And the sound of the trumpet was very loud, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Sinai was completely in smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain. I'll stop reading there. It's a bit lengthy of a read. But what's so fascinating there is God using this trumpet sound. And you can only imagine how frightening that would have been with the lightnings, the thunderings, the smoke on the mountain, as well as this tremendous trumpet that grew louder and louder. But it's God calling his people together. They were to come near him. And we see the same thing in 1 Thessalonians. In fact, that's not the only spot we see it. If you go to Matthew chapter 24, there's another instance when Jesus was speaking of the destruction of Jerusalem. He talks about gathering his saints together, knowing who his saints are, knowing those who are not going to experience his wrath. And he talks about it there in Matthew 24 and mentions again the sound of the trumpet and gathering his elect together. Now that was spiritually. It wasn't a physical gathering there in the first century, just spiritually, God knowing who were his and collectively having them as his people, as his church. And so very fascinating, I think, that when we come to 1 Thessalonians, and there's another text actually, and that's we might have time to look at that too, and that's 1 Corinthians chapter 15. But the trumpet is also mentioned there, and there it's mentioned as the last trumpet. So the one in 1 Thessalonians that we're looking at already is the last trumpet. So the final gathering of God's people, the very last gathering of God's people. And where are they gathered to? Well, it says that God gathers them into the air. We meet the Lord in the air, and then he says we're always with him. All right, Keith, I'll kick it back to you.
All right, and I want to begin my segment of this then by emphasizing what Trevor just said. That's directly from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, that they shall ever be with the Lord. When the saints are gathered up, it won't be for 7 years. Thus they shall ever, always be with the Lord. And so it's not to return to this earth again. There's no promise in the Scriptures that Jesus Christ will ever be on this earth again. I want to look at another passage now, rather lengthy one. I'll try not to take too much time on it because I want Trevor to be able to speak some more. In 2 Peter chapter 3, that also talks about the Lord's second coming. So if you'd like to follow along in your Bibles, in 2 Peter chapter 3, I'm going to begin reading in verse 1. Beloved, I now write to you this second epistle, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. For this they willfully forget, that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with water. Now the word world there is used in the sense not of the entire creation, but of all the place where humans live. That was their world, where they lived. It was destroyed by water. Of course, that's talking about the flood of Noah. Now, the first part of it is talking about the creation, where the earth arose out of the waters. The land, dry land, rose out of the waters, as we read in Genesis chapter 1. But in Genesis chapter 6 through 8, we read of the flood of Noah's day, in which that world was destroyed by water. Now, verse 7, but the heavens and the earth. Now, see, it doesn't say the world. It's not just the place where humans live. This is the heavens and the earth. This is the totality of the physical creation, which are now preserved by the same word, are reserved for fire. Now, the world of that time was destroyed by water. The heaven and the earth, totality of God's physical creation, it's reserved for fire, not water. reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition. The word perdition means destruction of ungodly men. There's coming a time where the ungodly will be destroyed. But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. It doesn't mean God can't tell time. God created time. It means that time is irrelevant with God as far as His fulfilling His promise. Whether it takes Him one day or 1,000 years, God's going to fulfill His promise. He exists forever. He can always fulfill His promise. The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing, or toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Now, that's the reason God allows things to go on. He's trying to get ungodly sinners to come to repentance so they can be saved. Now, but the day of the Lord. Now, the phrase day of the Lord is consistently used in Scriptures of a day of judgment. And as Trevor pointed out concerning the last trumpet, this is the last day of the Lord. This is the last judgment. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. There's not going to be any warnings ahead of time. Thieves don't tell you ahead of time they're coming to break in and steal what you have. They come secretly. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away. Is Jesus going to be on this earth again? When He comes again, the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Even the elements of which this universe is made up, they're going to pass away. They're going to be destroyed with fervent heat. But the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, they're not going to be here for Jesus to walk on. They're going to cease to exist. They're going to be dissolved. Since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, that is the day of judgment, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to His promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. That phrase, new heavens and new earth, is a phrase that originates with Isaiah, and it means a complete new order of things. This earth is going to be gone. This material universe is going to be gone. There's going to be a complete new order of things. All right, Trevor, I'm through. I'll let you take over now. Thank you.
All right. I'm going to kick over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and there's a couple of passages here I think that would be good to look at. Beginning in verse 20 of the chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he's talking about the resurrection of the dead. He speaks about how Christ is the first to rise from the dead, and then afterwards those who belong to Christ. He says in verse 20, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. But each one in his order," in his own order. Now here's the order of things. Christ, the first fruits, well, he's the first to rise from the dead. Afterward, those who are Christ at his coming, that's all of God's people that we've been looking at when that last trumpet sounds. And then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father and puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. So there's the order, and again, there's no mention of him setting foot on the earth, or, you know, Keith, you brought up a teaching about setting up a kingdom on this earth for a period of time, and there's no mention of that. In fact, what he says is Christ is risen, at his coming, all of his people will rise, and then comes the end. That's the very next step, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father and puts an end to all rule and authority and power. But there's another portion of the text I'd also like to read, and that's down in verse 50. Same chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, but in verse 50. Now, this is the text I mentioned a little bit earlier, you may or may not remember, but about the last trumpet, the very last trumpet sounding. Saw back there in the book of Exodus, the first trumpet, God gathering his people. I mentioned Matthew 24, an example of God speaking of a trumpet, gathering his people, spiritually speaking. But here, this is the final trumpet. It says in verse 50, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Now what he's referring to, Paul uses that word asleep or sleeping, referring to being dead. And what he's saying is there's going to be people on the earth when Jesus comes. And there's going to, of course, we've had a lot of folks already pass on, but people are going to be alive when the Lord comes. We shall not all sleep. Not all, everybody's going to be dead. But we shall all be changed. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. So there's the final trumpet, the final gathering of God's people. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So our bodies are going to be changed. We'll be given a heavenly body, a body that is permanent, and a body that will always be with God, as we already saw in 1 Thessalonians. So in God, in the heavenly places, in the heavenly realm, always to be with God. But again, that last trumpet, I just think that's such a fascinating picture, how God shows us the gathering of his people in the Old Testament, the gathering of his people when he comes again, and then getting to always be with the Lord. And I don't think we read it, Keith, but in 1 Thessalonians there, immediately following that, Paul says, comfort one another with these words. And that's a good part of the text. We shouldn't have left that out. These things are a comfort to those who are doing the will of God. And if you are Christ at his coming, you're going to be caught up in the air with the Lord, and you'll always be with him. That final trumpet sounds, God's going to gather all of his people. So those are things that should bring us comfort as well.
Outstanding, Trevor. Thank you very much. That's such good comments, and I appreciate that. Now, the question we're dealing with is, will Jesus ever set foot on this earth again? And there's no such promise in the New Testament that Jesus will ever set foot on this earth again. Now, for you who are watching this program, if you think we're wrong on this, if you believe there is such a passage, then call or write, Trevor or me, and let us know what that passage is that promises that one day Jesus will set foot on this earth again. And let me, the significance of this, and we'll be drawing the program to a close pretty quickly. The significance of this is that people believe that the Bible teaches that there's going to be a future material kingdom on this earth of Jesus reigning on this physical earth again. The usual book of the Bible that people go to try to find the promise of a future kingdom on this earth is the book of Revelation. So Trevor, I'm going to end my part of this program, then hopefully have time to turn it back to you, by looking at one verse from the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 9. Revelation chapter 1, verse 9. I, John, both your companion, your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. At the time John wrote the book of Revelation, he was in the kingdom. I'm not looking for a future kingdom. I'm in the kingdom. So was John. Trevor, are you in the kingdom?
Absolutely.
Okay. Conclude the program, please, for us.
Well, I was trying to get to a passage, but I don't think I'm going to have enough time. But Colossians 1:13, you know, going along with what you just said made me think of this passage where Paul says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. So not future tense there, but present tense, that God has conveyed us into his kingdom. So if you are Jesus Christ, you belong to him, you're in his church, then when the last trumpet sounds, you'll be caught up in the air, always to be with the Lord. Thanks for watching.
Thank you for watching Search the Scriptures. If you have a Bible question or comment, you may call 870-321-5746, email keithsharp at suddenlink.net, or write Keith Sharp at P.O. Box 263, Mountain Home, Arkansas 72654, and your question will be answered on the air. Be sure to watch next week at the same time for another edition of Search the Scriptures. Until then, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.